Sir, we'll start, sir.
Okay, madam, we'll start.
Yes, sir. I request Vishwanath sir to take over.
Yeah, I will take over, yeah.
Yes.
I think you are able to see my screen.
Yes, sir.
So welcome back. This is in continuation to my previous day's lecture. So in this lecture, we are going to see supervised learning basically. So supervised learning, because it is part of machine learning, and the machine learning is part of artificial intelligence. So let us go in this hierarchy. So as usual, if you are having any questions, you can ask me in between also. I think I am audible and there is no audio issues are there. Are you getting any echo or something like that?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so I will go ahead. So this is the agenda for today, and if there is time, we can see something about unsupervised problems also. So see, the artificial intelligence is from the 1950 to 1990, and basically at that period what happened is that it was all rule based. Rule based means we code the rules. Actually, we say to the computer what to do and when to do something. It's a rule based. If this is the condition, then take this action. Maybe something like that. Up to 1990, it was like that. After 1990, machine learning came into picture. Okay. People will say that the machine learning is part of this bigger picture. To draw this one, what people say is that if AI is like this, AI, then ML is going to be within this one. Machine learning. And nowadays what is happening is deep learning. Deep learning, I will write this one as deep learning. So this is part of machine learning nowadays. So this is the big picture, and what happens is that most of the techniques used in machine learning can be used for data analytics also, because you are having predictive data analytics, right? Predictive data analytics is nothing but supervised learning. That means you want to predict something. It is almost similar to the regression or the classification problem. So that's why the supervised learning may be important for data analytics. Okay, so we will see that one. So as we have seen that AI was coined in 1956 itself in some conference, and the ML was also coined around 1952 or so. Okay, and it became popular in 1957 by something called as perceptron, which was invented by a researcher called Rosenblatt. Okay, so now let us go into the techniques of machine learning. Here, one can see that these techniques of AI or ML in general can be categorized as deductive and inductive. This is important to understand. Deductive means we are going to give the program and we give the input, the computer is going to give us the output. This is what basically deductive means. We give the program. That means, for example, we want to multiply two numbers, let us say that, or we want to find the square root of a number, then we are going to give the algorithm, that means we are going to give the program, maybe in C language or Python, whatever is that, we write the program and we give a number, it's going to find the square root of the number, right? So this is same as saying that the rules for a game is given and the computer is going to play the game according to the rules, right? So this is what is called as deductive learning, and some people argue that this is not learning at all because you are saying everything, right? For example, if you teach a child about multiplying two numbers, now we generally call this one as learning only, right? But this type of learning is inferior learning, where we tell what to do and we give the input. So based on what we told, that is a method, the input has to be processed and the output has to be given, right? So this was the AI. Actually, in olden days, AI was this one. Now, inductive means we don't give the program, actually. We don't give the method. But what we are going to give is that we give examples saying that if this is the input, then that has to be the output. Okay. So we are going to give some examples saying that if I am, for example, if it is the multiplication, you want to give examples, we will say that 2 comma 3, then the output has to be 6. Or we can say that 10 comma 20, then the output has to be 200. So like this, we are going to give some examples. We will not say how we got this. Right. Okay. So if this input output pairs are given, that is examples are given, we ask the computer or we ask the machine itself to learn the program. Are you able to understand? Now the machine has to learn the program. Learn the program means, that means it should know what are the rules actually. Learn the program. This is similar to saying that now you learn what are the rules which is going to map these inputs to these outputs. Okay. So this is what is called as inductive learning. Okay. Are you able to understand this one? Difference between this one, deductive and inductive. This inductive learning is what generally comes under machine learning. And one of the biggest things under this one is supervised learning. Supervised learning. Okay. Now, for example, if it is a rule-based one, you might have seen the computer playing chess or whatever is that, right? Nowadays, it is very easy to get these programs and to be installed even in your mobile phone. So how actually these things are done is that we are going to encode the rules, right? And we will give the method actually, that is how to explore the search space. That is, if it is a tic-tac-toe, then we will explore. If I am going to make this step, the opponent is going to make that step. And after that, I am going to make this step. So it's like a tree. It's going to become like a big tree. We are going to explore this one. And we are going to choose from the current board position, we are going to choose what is best for us, right? So this process of exploring the search space and choosing the best move is written by us. So that's why this is called as inductive learning. I think most of you might have seen this type of things in artificial intelligence, right? Maybe you might have heard about some techniques like BFS, DFS, and some techniques like you might have heard about A-star algorithm. A-star is one of the celebrated techniques in artificial intelligence. A-star algorithm, it is called. Similarly, there are this breadth first search is there. Some other techniques are also there. Depth first search is also there. These techniques can be used to explore the search space. That is, to explore the space of various board positions. And then we are going to choose the best step based on some criteria. All these things are given by us. Okay. So this is like giving the rules, right? But you cannot give rules for something like self-driving car. Self-driving car, you cannot give rules, right? How many rules we are going to give, and how is that we are going to give these rules? Even for fingerprint recognition, we cannot give rules actually. But it may be possible for some problems like fingerprint and all these things. We can say that this many cones are there, this many. There are certain features are there in each fingerprint image. Those things can be extracted by image processing, and then you can give a rule kind of thing. Okay. But in general, for face recognition or for speech recognition or for some problems like that, you cannot give the rules actually. Okay. So there, what one can give is only examples. So we can give examples, saying that this is the correct way of driving pattern. If this is the road, one has to drive like this. That example can be given, and this is the wrong way of driving, perhaps that example also can be given, right? So this examples is what is called as data, right? So we are going to give data. Now from the data we want the machine to learn, right? Perhaps we are going to give for each one of these examples, we are going to give the output also. So that's why it is called as, sometimes this data is called as the training set. Okay. So machine will learn rules from the data. We are not going to give the rules. This is what is called as machine learning, right? So it is almost like this. So now the data is very important, and then the algorithm which is going to automatically extract the rules or something similar to rules from this data are important, right? So without data, machine learning is not there. So that is the reason perhaps saying that many machine learning techniques can be applied for analysis, data analysis, something like that. Okay. Now, machine learning is interdisciplinary. We know that it is, it has taken many ideas from many disciplines, and one can see that the probability statistics is there. Okay, here it is there, right? And also data mining is there. The optimization techniques are there. So many things are there actually. So these things may be common between data analytics and machine learning, right? Something may be here, for example, neurophysiology. These things may be particular to machine learning. But otherwise, most of the things one can see that are same as that is for data analytics. Okay. So now inductive learning, supervised learning techniques are there. This is what we are going to see in this lecture, basically. So here we are going to study about the classification, regression, so on. There is unsupervised learning also. So something like clustering, density estimation, these things are called unsupervised. We'll see why it is called unsupervised. Even here data is important. There is a slight difference between supervised learning and unsupervised learning. Okay, there are other types of learning also, like reinforced learning. See, reinforced learning is not supervised or unsupervised actually, but it is like reward and punishment, saying that at this stage of, at this environment, at this position or at this stage, what is the best step to take? For example, if the robot is navigating, So it will see what are all the obstacles and all these things, and it is going to find out what is the optimal step for it in order to reach its goal. Okay, so how is that we are going to train this one? So it is going to learn. Initially it will learn fundamentally by trial and error, and we say that whenever it is going to do well, we give a reward. Something reward means, see, finally it is an algorithm or it's a program. Within the program, the criterion, we are going to increase the value of that one. If it is going to do wrong, we will give punishment. Okay, and we will ask that to increase the cumulative reward. That is the goal. The goal of that one is to increase the cumulative reward the robot is going to get. So this type of learning is called as reinforced learning. And in the self-driving cars, most of the time this is used actually. Okay. And one of the important things are prerequisites of supervised learning or unsupervised learning is learning what are the good features. In the yesterday's class also we have seen the good features. We can find what are the good features for this problem. Perhaps many features are not needed, right? So this is one of the important sub problems of the machine learning, so that we are going to represent the data in a precise or in a concise way. Okay, we are going to say that these are the important features. Even though you have given 1000 features, only 5 or 6 features are important. So finding out this one is important, because finally you are going to create your model based on the data, right? So the number of columns in the data should not be too many actually, because that is going to determine the number of parameters you have to learn. Okay, so it is always better to reduce the number of features. So what are the good features, right? So this was one of the important problems actually. For example, in the speech recognition or video recognition or image recognition, something like that, the earlier days there was something called as pre-processing. For example, image processing is there, right? Digital image processing. What this will do, this is going to take an image and it is going to output the important features. See, the image may be 1024 by 1024 image may be there, right? And yesterday's class also we have seen, it is not correct to work with this one 1024 by 1024 image as it is. That is 1 million pixels. If you are going to work with this one, this is not correct, this is not good, this is not feasible. There are many problems with this one. So given an image, we have to extract relevant features. So feature extraction has to be done. Okay. So one of the techniques is PCA or SVD. This is what we have seen, right? Earlier days, maybe until last 10 years before, this is a separate field actually, feature extraction. This is what basically ECE people will be doing, or electrical people will be doing. They know the signals. They say that image is a signal, speech is a signal, so on. And they know how to extract the relevant features from that one, so that you can do your classification problem or something like that. Okay. But nowadays what happened is that recently from 2012 onwards, the trend is we are not doing this one actually. Feature extraction, we are not doing explicitly for some problems like image problems or video problems or audio problems, speech problems. We are not doing this one separately actually. We merged this one into the classifier learning. So this is where when we are going to bypass this one in certain domains, and we are directly going to integrate this along with the learning problem, this is what is called as deep learning nowadays. In deep learning, this step is bypassed. Okay, we may see some examples for this later on. Okay. So we will come to the supervised learning. What is this one? See, there is a training phase or the learning phase. See, this is an example, and most of the time I show this example actually. Maybe some of you who might have attended my previous lectures can find this one as same example. See, we are having two types of animals are there. Cats are there, dogs are there. Many pictures of dogs and cats, we are going to show it to a child. We show the child that these are all dogs, these are all cats. Okay. The child is going to look into this one for some time. And after that, what we do is that to the child, we give a picture. See, this picture as it is not there in the training set. This picture is not there. Actually, in the training examples, this is not there. So the child will look into this one, and the child is going to say something. Perhaps the child will say that this is dog. Okay. Right. So that means the child has learned what is that distinguishes between dog and cat. So this is supervised learning. Okay. See, this picture as it is not in the training set. Okay. See, the child has done more than remembering. Child hasn't photographically remembered the images of dogs and images of cats. No, child hasn't done that one. Child has done beyond that. So child has learned what is that it is common among dogs and what is that it is common among cats, and also what are the distinguishing features or attributes between cats and dogs. Right? This is what the child has done, isn't it? So the child has learned the pattern, that is the regularity behind all dogs. There is some regularity is there behind all dogs. Maybe the face is going to be like this, or the size is going to be like this, or the tail is going to be like this, something, right? There is a pattern, there is a regularity among all dogs. Similarly, there is a regularity among all cats, right? Now, child then recognized a test image as having a particular pattern, which is unique to dogs. So that's why the child has said that the given image is a dog image, right? So that's why in olden days, the machine learning was called as pattern recognition. Some of you might have heard this one, right? Pattern recognition was a discipline. Even now, ECE people might be studying this one. Pattern recognition is nothing but machine learning only. But they call this one as pattern recognition. Okay, so how is that we are going to do this one? For example, if I am going to give a cat or dog image, what is that I have to do? I need to find the features. So assuming that I am going to find the features like this, there are D features. That means the given objects, real world object, maybe the image of the cat or dog, I am going to extract the features. The features can form a feature vector, right? So this is the feature vector. Right, this is the feature vector. It has D features. Assume that it has D features. So a particular object that is the feature vector, we can call it as X. Or maybe we are having so many objects are there. So then we can call that one as X1, X2, so on, right? Maybe there are N data elements are there. We are going to call this one like this, right? Now, for each one of these things, there is a label also is there, right? Saying that, for this feature vector, the label is something like a cat. Maybe the cat I will call as Y1. For this also, the label is cat. For the third one, the label is dog. So on, right? Maybe for the last one, the label is cat. If there are only two labels are there, then we are going to assign to each one of these examples, which we are going to give, right? This is available with us. So for each one of these feature vectors, we are going to give the label. So So in general, the set of labels might be this capital Y. There might be several labels. It's not, it need not be only two labels, right? In general, you can say that there are C labels are there. Maybe elephant is also there, camel is also there, something like that, right? So, and these feature vectors, we are going to see this one, these feature vectors, if you see all these feature vectors, possible values for all these features, this will form a vector space. Vector space means it's a set of vectors, okay. And now the problem is, it's a set of vectors. So now the problem is, the given image, from the image we know how to extract this feature vector. Given the feature vector, let us say, I'm going to give the feature vector, let us say, xj. This is something I'm going to give. Okay. From the real world object, I have extracted features. And this feature vector, I'm going to call this one as xj. This one, I want to classify. I want to find out whether this is dog or cat. So this one, I'm going to give to a program. Okay, that program is F. This program is going to output the output label. In this case, it is going to be either cat or dog. Right. So now, the problem of supervised learning is learning this program F actually, learning this function F from the given training example. So this is the training example. Training examples. From these training examples, you have to learn this function. This is basically a program which is going to map the given input feature vector to the class label. Okay, so that's why this is nothing but function learning. We are trying to learn this function F, which is going to map the set of feature vectors to the set of labels, right? Are you able to understand this problem? We want to find this F actually. What is this F? So there are so many techniques. Given, what is given to us? That is the data. Here in this case, this data is, because it has labels also, these are the labels, it has labels also, this is called as training data. This is called as training data or training examples. Given training data, we want to learn this function F. This is the problem, that's all. This is what is called as supervised learning problem. Okay. And sometimes this cat and dog is a two class problem. We say that because it is a two class problem, you can represent a cat with a zero, dog with one, right? It's a binary classifier. I'm going to say whenever it is going to output zero, it is cat. Whenever it is going to output one, it is dog, right? Given a feature vector as input, we are going to output either zero or one in this example. Are you able to understand? Now, is this looks trivial for you? After all, you are going to take a feature vector and you are going to output either 0 or 1. How many of you feel that this is too trivial, too obvious? Are you able to hear me? Am I audible properly?
Sir, yes, sir.
So we'll go ahead. Yeah. Now this is one more example. Given a person, now the person might have so many features, right? Color is there, his name is there, right? Height is there, weight is there, age is there. So many features are there, but we want to classify the person as overweight or normal person. Okay, so somehow we came to know that these are the important features for us, height and weight. If we know height and weight, we can classify the person as overweight or normal. So we can build this classifier F, which is going to map these feature vectors into the label overweight or normal. Okay. So somebody told us that the height and weight are important. Some doctor might have told us that if your problem is to classify the person as overweight or normal person, then these are the two features important, and there is no need to find the age of the person and all these things. Okay. Right. So this is the traditional machine learning was like this. Feature extraction either is done by special techniques and all these things. Okay. And then after doing the feature extraction, we are going to get the feature vectors. Then we are going to create the classifier, which is F. Okay. So once we are going to have this F, we can test this one actually with the test examples. We can say that this is the error rate of this F. F is the classifier. Okay. This is what traditionally machine learning was like this. So the sensed image or the sensed signal, whatever is that, pre-processed features are extracted, that is the feature vector is obtained. Okay. So this is done for several real world objects. So it is going to form the training set. By using the training set, we are going to somehow learn this function F. So this function is the classifier actually. We can find out how good is this classifier by employing this one over the test set, and we can give the error rate for this classifier, something like that. Okay. This is how it was done, maybe until 15 years back or 20 years back. Okay. But for some problems, nowadays, this is not followed actually for some problems, especially for images and videos or some problems like that. This is not followed actually nowadays. We'll see that one. Now, features. What are the good features? From the given thing, you are going to extract the features. The features, if they are good for classification, then if I'm going to extract two features, let us say if it is overweight and a normal person, two features if I'm going to extract, maybe all these people are overweight people or something like that. I'm not exactly sure, but maybe it is possible that with the height and weight, the data is going to look like this. That is, it is clustered like that, well separated clusters of overweight people from the normal people we are going to get if it is good features, right? And the classifier somehow is this one. This is the classifier F. Okay. This can be learned easily in this case. If you are going to use bad example, for example, for the same overweight and normal person, for example, the age is given, let us say, and something like, let us say his sugar level is given, glucose level. If we are going to do this kind of thing, you will not be able to classify between overweight and normal person, right? These are bad features actually. This is, it cannot capture the classification between overweight and normal people. So this is a bad set of features. You cannot create a classifier with these features. So we require good features. So that's why the feature extraction was one of the important research areas until some 5 years back or 10 years back. Even now it is important in many areas. It is important except in some few areas like images and videos. It is nowadays it is being done automatically. Okay. Otherwise, it has to be done by using some special techniques. Feature extraction has to be done by using some special techniques. Okay. Now, for this example, maybe if I'm going to have like this, the overweight people are like this. Overweight people are like this. Normal people are like this. If I'm going to have like this, so I can see this each person I can see as a point in this 2D space, right? This 2D space is called, this is what is called as a vector space. Okay, now how is that we are going to build the classifier? Okay, the feature extraction, so we assume that somehow this is done. There are so many techniques for doing the feature extraction. You can skip this one. Now, nowadays what is happening in the domains like signal related domains, nowadays feature extraction is not there. Okay, there is the classifier learning technique is there. This is going to learn the classifier, right? To this classifier, we are going to give, directly we are going to give the image to this classifier. Directly this is going to give the output like cat and dog. Okay, so in between feature extraction is not there nowadays. So this is called as deep learning. This is called as deep learning. And this is the cutting edge nowadays for, in machine learning, this is the cutting edge nowadays. But still in many areas, like if you are going to have sensor data is there, some other sensor data is there, or the inventory data is there, something related to, for example, the students data like marks is there, something like that. In that, in those fields, still traditional machine learning has to be used. Okay, are you able to understand? Then, given training set, we are going to create a classifier. This is the problem. Okay, and then one has to evaluate how good is our created classifiers, right? See, of course, one normally sees that it has to agree with the training set. That means if I am going to create the classifier F from the training set D, if there is a training example in this one, let us say the training example X is already there in this D, if I am going to give this X to this F, whatever is the label available here, the same label this has to give. In the training set D, X has label, let us say Y. Okay. Then the classifier I am going to create has to give the label Y. Because after all, I created this F by using the training set. Right. So usually people will think that the classifier has to do extremely well with the training set. Or they say that they have to, it has to do correctly, 100% correctly with the training set, the F. Whenever I am going to give the example from the training set itself, it has to give correct label. This is what normally we do, right? Now, while this looks all right, but the classifier has to do more than this. What do we mean by more than this? The classifier has to classify something which is not in the training set also. Okay. Okay, right? The classifier has to do well with the unseen, that is, which is not there in the training set also. The classifier is, has to do well. Okay. So, actually, this is the measure actually. The measure is that it's not measured over the training set. When you want to measure the goodness of the classifier, it is measured over the examples which are not there in the training set. Okay. And the reason is that there is a classifier called as a rote learning classifier, which is simply going to remember the training sets. Training set is simply remembered saying this is the feature vector, this is the label. The training set is stored in a form of a table. Okay. And whenever you are going to give a pattern X to be classified, you will search here. Is it going to match exactly with any one of these things? If it is going to match exactly with, for example, with this one, then I am going to output that label is already there with me. I am going to output this label, right? So this classifier, which is basically remembering the training set in a table, and then setting the training the table, and then outputting whatever is there the label in the table, is also a classifier, right? And this classifier will do 100% correct with the training sets, because after all the training examples are available here. This is going to do 100% correct with the training set. So evaluating the classifier over the training set is not the criteria. And this classifier, if I am going to give something which is not in the training set, this classifier is going to randomly give the class label. It is going to randomly choose either cat or dog. It may toss a coin and then say that this is cat, this is dog, something like that. Okay, so this type of learning has a name. This is called as rote learning. In fact, our classifier should not do this one. It has to work well with the unseen, that is with the training, that is with the examples which are not there in the training sets. It has to do well. Okay. Now the classifiers, that is the ways in which the classifier can be created, there are so many ways are there. That is, all these are going to find F. Given D, all these are going to find the classifier F. Base classifier is there, perceptron, HMM classifiers are there, artificial neural networks are there, decision trees are there, something like support vector machines are there. Nowadays, deep learning is there, right? So we are going to see these things. Maybe this base classifier we are going to skip. Okay. Now, there is yet another way to categorize the classifier building techniques. These can be called as generative models, discriminative models. So the way in which we are going to create the classifier F, there are two ways in which the classifier F can be created. First one is generative models. So here, what we do is that from the given training set, we will try to estimate, we are going to estimate the probability structure of the data. So something like we are going to find out the distribution from which the data is coming. That means we are going to estimate what is the source from which the data is coming. Then we can use something like a Bayes rule or something like that to classify. Okay, so this is what is called as generative models. That means we are trying to find out how the data is generated, and we are going to use those characteristics which are responsible for the data generation in classifying, and these are called as generative models. The Bayes classifier or naive Bayes classifier are like this. So we are going to learn about the distribution basically. The other way of learning the classifier F is discriminative models. So here we don't learn about the distribution or something like that. We learn what is that which is going to discriminate between the classifiers. Okay. So now if you want to understand this in a better way, then the then this is somehow is going to know the summary. This is going to summarize the data. Or this is going to learn the description of the data. And based on this one, it is going to classify. Okay. If you can summarize the data, means you understood the data, right? If you are capable of summarizing the data which belongs to cats, the data which belongs to dogs, that means that you know about from where this data is coming and all these things, right? On the other hand, this one is discriminative. Discriminative means this knows how to distinguish between cat and dog. That's all. This doesn't know how to summarize. Okay. This knows only what is the distinguishing feature between the classes. Okay. So now the important thing is that if you are interested, this can be used to generate new examples. Because once you are having the distribution or something like that, it can be used to generate new examples, right? But this one, even though you know what is that going to discriminate between the classes, even though you know this one, you cannot create new examples. This don't have that capacity. New example creation capacity is not there in the discriminative model. And we don't need this one. If our purpose is to create a classifier, we don't need that, right? Okay. And in supervised learning, most of the time, this is winning actually. This is the winning one. It's not that summarizing one is the winning one. The discriminating one is the winning one. Okay. So within this one, we are getting this logistic regression or linear classifier, support vector machine, artificial neural network, decision trees, all these are coming here. Only very few things like Bayesian classifier, naive-Bayes classifier, something like that. These are all something like old classifiers or something like that are coming here. Okay. Now there is a classifier called k-nearest neighbor classifier. Many of you might have known this one. Okay. And this classifier, what this will do is that you assume that there are two classes are there, and this is the training set is given on the screen. There is a blue circles are there, white squares are there. Assume that this is the label. The label is blue circle is one label, white square is the other label. This is the training example is there. It has only two attributes. Okay. And we are asked to classify this one. Is this belongs to blue or white? So if you are going to give this one, what this k-nearest neighbor classifier will do is that, what are the neighbors for this one? So you want to classify this new point, right? The new point you want to classify as blue or white. Now, for the new point, the neighboring points are they blue or are they white? We are going to see that one. Based on that one, it is going to classify. So how many neighboring points one has to see? For example, if we are going to see only one neighboring point, then the given one we are going to classify as blue, right? The given one we are going to classify as white actually. If we are going to see only one neighbor, the nearest neighbor for this one is white, white square, isn't it? But you can feel that the given one mostly belongs to the blue circle class. Right? So, and the problem may be something like actually, the problem may be that even though this white thing is occurring here, even though this white query is occurring here, it is occurring here because of noise. Actually, it has to occur somewhere here, the white square. Even though my color is blue here, assume that this is occurring there because of some mistake actually. Some error, some noise. Actually, it has to be here. But because of some noise, it went here. Okay. Right. So now, how is that we are going to tackle this problem? Because the noise can do the harm. So then they say that you can increase the number of neighbors you are seeing. If I'm going to see three neighbors for the given one, among three neighbors, two are blue, one is white. So I am going to classify it as blue. The majority vote will say that it is blue, right? Okay. Right. So this is what is called as k-nearest neighbor classifier. Right. Okay. Are you able to understand this? Many of you might have seen this, right? Now the question is this classifier generative or discriminative? Is there any answer? You can say any answer actually. The K-nearest neighbor classifier, is it generative or is it discriminative?
Discriminative, sir.
Is there any other answers? The only other answer is generative, right? Many people believe that it is discriminative. But actually this is generative. Okay. And in fact, it is very close to the base classifier. See, what actually I am doing here is that, let me erase the ink on this slide. I will tell you why I am calling this one as very close to the base classifier. When I am trying to find, let us say that the three neighbors, so the probability of getting blue around this given test point, the test example, around this, the probability of getting blue is 2/3. The probability of getting white is 1/3. Right. And from the training set, actually I can find what is the probability of getting blue. That is the distribution of this blue class. Actually I can create this one, right? And from that one, I can find this probability. This is what actually I found. I'm saying majority vote is 2 means what? Out of 3, it is 2. So the probability that the given thing is X, the probability that it belongs to the blue class, given X, is 2/3. The probability that it belongs to the white class, given X, is 1/3. So this is coming into picture. Actually, you can generate examples from this training set. Actually, how you can generate examples? Is there any idea how one can generate examples? See, the easy way is that you take any neighboring points, some three neighboring points or something like that. For example, I am going to take three neighboring points like this. The centroid of three points may be going to be somewhere here. Okay. Going to be somewhere here, right? This is a new one. The centroid is mostly belongs to the this class. Okay. This is one easy way to generate examples, right? Okay, so K-nearest neighbor classifier is generative model, and this is an approximated base classifier. Okay, you can read some textbooks also for this one, why I'm calling this one as generative model. Okay, now this one, if I am going to say that I'm going to learn this discriminant, actually the function which is going to discriminate between two classes. And what I am going to do is that whenever I am given with something to be classified, let us say that something to be classified is this one. This one I want to classify. What I am going to do, that one I am going to put into this one, put into this F. Into this F, I am going to put this, whatever for this X, going to have two features are going to be there. Those two features I am going to put into this one, and I am going to find the value of this one. If this is going to be greater than 0, it belongs to one class. Otherwise, it belongs to the other class. Okay. Right. So, given any point now, I can employ this formula. I will evaluate this formula on that test point. And whenever it is less than 0, it belongs to one class. Greater than 0, it belongs to the other class. Okay. He is also a classifier, right? So here, the classifier learning means what? Classifier learning means finding this formula. Finding this formula F. This is what is called as classifier finding. And this obviously, this is a discriminant classifier. Because this is going to discriminate, that's all. Even you can give something here also. It is going to say that it belongs to the class 2 only. Okay. Knowing this F, forgetting about the training set. See, after learning this F, you don't require the training set, right? Training set can be thrown away. So, just by knowing this F, you can do classification, but you cannot generate examples. Are you accepting? So linear classifier means the discriminant function is going to look like this one. And what is that we are going to learn from the training set is these parameters W1, W2, B. These are the three parameters that has to be learnt here. Once we know these three parameters, we are having this function F. For given features X1 and X2, we can employ this formula and we can find out what is the output of this one. Is it positive or is it negative? If it is positive, if the class is class 2. If it is negative, the class is class 1. Okay. This is one of the fundamental discriminant based classifiers. This is what is called as perceptron. Perceptron means this classifier only. And in 1960s itself, people found a technique, an algorithm to learn these parameters W1, W2 and B. Those parameters are there, right? Here, W1, W2 and B. Given the training set, which is linearly separable means there is a linear discriminant, that is a straight line, which is going to correctly classify the training set. If that is the kind of data given, then W1, W2 and B can be found. An algorithm for finding W1, W2 and B was given around 1956 itself. This is the first algorithm in the literature of machine learning, something. Rosenblatt gave this one. Okay, and this algorithm, still people are using this one. You might be surprised to note this one. This algorithm is such a good one, still people are using this one. And this is a very simple one also. Okay, so given the training set, it can learn the linear discriminant function. Perceptron, okay. So it is possible, right? Now, the thing is that the linear classifier, many linear classifiers are possible. Okay, based on your initial conditions and how the data is sorted, which one is going to come first, which one is going to come last, many things. And the technique is going to find any one of these things. It need not find the particular one always, right? Based on the order of the training set given to the learning algorithm, it is going to learn some of these things. Okay. Now, which one is good? There are several linear classifiers which are doing equally well with the training set. With the training set, all of them are doing equally well. But I told you that doing extremely well with the training set is not the criteria. It has to do well with the unseen patterns. So, in this three given classifiers, which one is going to do well with the unseen patterns? So, we are having a green classifier is there. This is violet, right? Violet classifier is there. Red classifier is there. Which one is going to do well with the unseen data? Among these three linear classifiers, which one is better? There is this blue classifier or violet. this color, you call it as what? This color? We will call this one as something like blue, dark blue classifier. This one is a green classifier. Classifier, I'm saying. This one is a red classifier. Which classifier is good? All these classifiers are doing 100% correct with the training set. Which one you are going to choose? Given a choice for you, which one you are going to choose? Huh? No answer? Some answer you can say, actually.
Why don't we mix all these classifiers, sir, as they are performing very well?
In the training set? See, that is something different, your answer. You are driving this in a different way, actually. But the question I asked is, which one is superior among these three? See,
red one
is superior, yes. Red one is superior. Among these three, red one is superior. But why? That is...
Distance.
Correct answer.
Margin distance.
Yeah. So, maybe. Now, the important thing, as I mentioned in the last slide also, is that... You might be having noise in the training data, right? And sometimes this need not be occurring here. This may be occurring slightly here. It may be perturbed from their original location. It may be perturbed one, right? So, how much noise it is going to tolerate? So, one can see that this red one can tolerate this noise to the greater extent, right? So red is better. All being doing well. So this is what the support vector machine means. Support vector machine says that you find the classifier. In this case, the linear classifier is the middle one. This is the linear classifier. This one, which I am drawing here, is linear actually. Even though I am drawing it, my drawing is not making it straight. It is linear classifier. This is the classifier. Okay, now what it will do is that for a linear classifier, it is going to find something called as margin width, width of that one. So width, one can see that is going to be something like how much the classifier can be perturbed parallelly. So if this is the classifier, then the width is going to be like this. For example, if this is the classifier, for this classifier, the width is, for this classifier, its width is this much. So now one can see that that classifier for which the width is maximum is having more tolerance towards the noise. Okay, so that is a good classifier. This is the idea behind the support vector machines. Idea behind the support vector machines is to find the best linear classifier. Okay. Right. And how to find this one is a big problem. That's what the entire support vector, how to find this classifier, in the machine learning book, it might go for two or three chapters actually. Okay. And there is one more way of finding the linear classifier, that is called as logistic regression. Okay, this is also one of the easy ways. After regression, people studied this one. And after this one only, they came to SVMs. Okay, logistic regression is one improvement over the perceptron. That improvement is perceptron classifier learning technique is going to be severely impaired with outliers. So if there are outliers in the training data, the perceptron learning algorithm is going to go wrong. Okay, so if this is the data, the perceptron learning algorithm is going to find this classifier. Okay, but if there is an outlier like this, in this case, this is the outlier, right? This outlier can cause damage to the classifier. The classifier it is going to learn is going to be like this. The classifier it is going to learn is going to be like this. This is not a good classifier, right? Because this is misclassifying even one of the training examples. This is misclassifying even one of the training examples, right? This happened because of this outlier. So this linear classifier learning techniques are sensitive to outliers. Okay, so logistic regression can overcome this problem. Okay, it is one more example. Because of this outlier, now the linear classifier is going to be like this. Now logistic regression, what it will do is that you can see that this classifier is something like this. What the linear classifier is doing, if I am going to have D features or something like that, or some features are there, then it is going to find the weighted thing of this one, W1 X1 plus W2 X2, so on, right? Is going to do this one. There are N features are there, WN, XN. And then it is going to add this W0 also to this one. And if this is going to be greater than 0, one class, less than 0, other class. Right. That means after doing this weighted summation here, it is going to employ this step function. And this is going to be the output. If it is positive, one class, negative, other class. This is what it is doing, right? Perceptron is doing like this only. But now, the logistic regression said that don't use this one, this step function. Step function is not correct. It said that you can use something called a sigmoid function. Instead of using the step function like this, sigmoid function is going to look like this. It is on one side it is 0, no doubt, on the other side it is 1, but it is not step, it's not like a step. Step is going to be like this, right? It's not a step like this. Instead, the function which we are going to do is going to smoothly vary. This is called as logistic regression. This function is called as sigmoid function. Okay. And if you employ this sigmoid function in the learning process of the linear classifier, then we are trying to fit this one to the data. So once we are going to fit this one to the data, the classifier is again a linear classifier only, but now it is going to tolerate the outliers. Okay, so what we have done is that instead of using the step function, we replace the step function with the sigmoid function, right? Then the next one is that, see, even this logistic regression is linear classifier only. Even logistic regression is linear only. This is finally going to give us a linear classifier. Because what we are going to do, we are going to cut this one at 0.5, exactly at 0.5. We are going to cut this one. When we are going to cut this one at 0.5, with a plane which is going to be parallel to the X1, X2 plane at 0.5. What we are going to get here is a straight line like this one. So on this side, because the feature space is what here? Feature space is X1, X2 plane, right? X1, X2 plane is the feature space. Okay, here the classifier is going to be straight line only. Okay. Are you able to understand this one? See, the X1, X2 plane here is the feature space. This is the space in which the training examples are going to be present. Okay. logistic regression also finds only linear classifier. But the advantage is that it can tolerate outliers. Okay. Right. Then the next one is that why only linear? We can go for non-linear classifiers, right? So then came one step beyond this logistic regression is artificial neural networks. This is also called as multi-layered perceptron. Multi-layered perceptron is also called. So here, one can see that if your perceptron is going to be only this one, see, this is what is the perceptron, right? Perceptron can be visualized like this. When this is going to be the step function, it is perceptron. When this is going to be the sigmoid function, it is logistic regression. Right. Here, we are having the input layer is there and the output layer is there. That's all right. So this is a two-layer network. But now, if I'm going to create one more layer in between the input layer and the output layer, see here the output layer is this one. This is the output layer actually. This put together is called as the output layer. Output layer is this one. This one is the input layer. Okay. If I create one more layer in between where I am going to do the summation here as I have done there, maybe I am going to employ the sigmoid after that, the output I am going to give. Okay. So this output I am going to give to all these things. So there is going to be weight here. Some W1, W2, all these things. Weights are there. Here also there are weights are there. Right. So if I am going to use one more layer here, then it is called as multi-layer perceptron. Okay. Now the multi-layer perceptron is capable of learning non-linear discriminant. Perceptron is capable of learning linear discriminant. Multi-layer perceptron is capable of learning non-linear discriminant. This is the advantage actually. You can see that this is one more example of the same thing. This is always multi-layer perceptron. And this is going to learn the discriminant, which is non-linear. And the learning procedure is popularly called as error back propagation. This is one of the celebrated techniques, error back propagation. Okay. This is a learning technique used here. And it is inspired from the biological neurons which are there in our brain. Mostly it is working like this. This is what we believe. Right. Right. It is going to learn the nonlinear discriminant like this. Okay. See, here there are two classes are there. The dark black is there and the white class is there, right? Class 0 and class 1, right? The discriminant, which is a better one, is a nonlinear one here. The linear discriminant is not going to work that much better here, right? Okay. So these type of things, the multilayer perceptron can learn. Right. And how it is going to, we are going to train this one is the important thing. And you see, even in data analytics also, if you want to do the predictive data analytics, you are given with the data and you want to predict what is going to happen. In that case, that is nothing but the classification problem only. Okay. See, SVM also can find nonlinear discriminant. We said that SVM is going to find the best perceptron, right? It can find nonlinear discriminant also. The same maximum margin principle is used, but it is going to employ something in between, which is called as, it can find like this. SVM also can find nonlinear discriminant having maximum margin like this. But what it is going to do is not something like a neural network, but it is going to map the data into a higher dimensional space, and in a higher dimensional space, it is going to find the perceptron. Okay. in the higher dimensional space, perceptron is non-linear classifier in the input space. Okay, you can see this example here. See, here there are two classes are there. They are separated by a non-linear classifier, right? Outside the circle it is white, inside the circle it is black. Circle is non-linear, right? It's not linear actually, it is non-linear. But now if you project this one onto a 3D space like this, it's going to become like this. Same data is going to look like this. In the 3D space, it is linearly separable. That means there is a hyperplane which is going to separate these two classes. Okay, so in this 3D space, you can again learn the perceptron. When this perceptron is translated back into the original input space, it is going to become like this. Okay, so this theory is there, and this is what SVM is doing. Okay, right. There is a competition between artificial neural networks and SVMs. Both can learn nonlinear discriminants. Error backpropagation is used in neural networks. Convex optimization is used in SVMs. Right. One important thing is that the neural network complexity of the neural network can be increased. That means it can handle large amounts of data. Only thing is that you have to increase the number of layers. Okay, this luxury is not available with the SVMs. So even though SVM is a superior one, this superiority is visible when the training set is limited. That is, when we are having a small training set, SVM is very much superior. But as the training set size increases, the millions and billions of examples are there, then you can increase the number of layers, in between layers, in the neural network. So that means the complexity of the classifier can be increased. Okay. So then this is going to do well actually with large data sets. This is what one of the principles in deep learning. Deep learning is nothing but neural network, that is multi-layer perceptron with some extra things, is what is called as deep learning. Okay. Right. So deep learning is ANN with many layers, and it is end-to-end model. Feature extraction it will do as it, and then there are some extra things it is done there. Okay, so there is no need to have handcrafted features by doing the pre-processing techniques. But the one of the limitations of this deep learning techniques is that it is applicable only for certain domains like images, videos and speech. It is not applicable in all domains. It is applicable only in certain domains. And one of the other important drawback is that it requires huge amounts of data. Okay. Deep learning nowadays is ruling the machine learning. The image is given at one end, several layers are going to be there. Finally, it is going to classify whether this is a person or car or animal like that. Several layers. Here it is given only three layers are there in between. There are four layers are there. But actually, there can be some 100 layers can be there in between. Okay. Then the important thing for data analytics is decision trees. Decision trees are very much used in data analysis. This is simple yet a popular classification technique. Okay, so and this can work with numerical data as well as with the categorical data. Categorical data means something like color is there. The color value is going to be red, green or blue or something like that. Or size is there, which is small, medium and large is the value. So then the what we have seen SVM or neural network will not work actually, right? Because you have to get that weighted summation. Weighted summation with categorical attributes is meaningless. We don't know what does it mean actually. What do you mean by three times blue plus two, two times red. What is this one? We don't know this one, right? So in those cases, Bayesian trees are handy. It is going to work well. And the Bayesian tree is a good classifier also. And it is very much used. And it is going to imply something related to information theory. In order to learn this Bayesian tree classifiers, we are going to use information theory techniques like entropy and all these things. Okay. And finally, this is going to give us explicit rules. Explicit rules it is going to give us. Okay. This is what is not there in ANN and SVM. Explicit rule saying that if this is the case, if this, then that is the class. So like that, it is going to give. So that's why, this is the reason why Bayesian trees are popular actually. It is going to give us, see, you have classified something, but what is the reason behind your classification? Why you classified like this? If you ask to a neural network or SVM, the answer it is going to give is not understandable to ordinary human being. Only for experts, it is understandable. For ordinary human beings, like managers in a bank or something like that, they will not understand. If you say that it's a sigmoid function we have used and all these things, they will not accept, right? They want something which is understandable by them. So for example, here, the attributes are like this. The attributes are something like color is attribute, okay, and size is attribute, shape is attribute. The data is like this, okay. And taste is attribute. Okay, we are going to have these values. The class label may be something like it is a watermelon class or apple or grape, okay, or lemon. So which fruit it is the class. The class label is going to be here, let us say. This is the class label, right? So what this is going to do is that, now this is a classifier actually. It is initially going to ask what is the color. If the color is green, it is going to ask what is the size. If the size is small, then the class it is going to give is grape. The green, small, it is grape. According to this data, it is grape. Similarly, if the color is yellow, and the shape is, let us say, thin, then the class it is going to give is banana. Okay. See, how this tree classifier is learned is a big question. Okay, but it is possible to learn this one. So once we are going to learn this, we are going to traverse this one. We are going to see the values. We are going to traverse this one. Maybe here we are going to follow the appropriate branch. After that, we are going to follow the appropriate branch. And then finally, we are going to come to the leaf. Leaf is going to give us the class label, right? If you see carefully here, what is that this is doing is that, if color is green and size is small, then class is grape. It's a rule, right? If somebody is going to ask you, why you classified it as grape? You can say that. Yes. Is there a question?
Vijayji.
No, no, I don't understand. Is there a question?
No, sir. She was unmuted. That's all.
Okay. So the explanation can be easily given. You can ask why you have classified it as grape, right? The answer to this one is because color is green, size is small. This happens for grape most of the time. So I have classified it as grape. Somebody can ask you why you have classified this as banana. Then you can say that the color is yellow and the shape is thin. So I have classified it as banana. Right. So this explanation is possible in the decision trees. This explanation is very important in the business management or somewhere like that. Because the customer will not accept, right? For example, if the loan application is rejected, the person will ask why my application is rejected. Then you have to tell him that your income is like this, your age is like this. All these things one has to say, right? You can't say that we employed ANN with sigmoid activation and it has given this one, so that's why your loan application is rejected. He will not accept, right? But if you are going to give something like this, he can accept, saying that yes, it is true. So my loan application being rejected is okay. Yeah. So this is the training set. Training set, as I said, maybe now the attributes need not be numerical attributes. It can be categorical attributes like this. What is the rank of that person? Assistant professor or professor or associate professor, and how many years he is working there, okay, and is he tenured or not? That means his position is extended or not, you want to find out. So then this is also a classification problem. You can create a classifier. So this is the training set. You can create a classifier where perhaps the classifier initially is going to ask what is the rank. The rank is going to be one of the three things: assistant professor, associate professor, professor. Okay. And if it is something like, let us say, associate professor, how many years of experience? Experience is again going to be a number, right? A integer. Integer, maybe it might be having several branches here. Or you might divide this one saying that less than or equal to 3 years, 3 to 5 years, 5 to 8 years, something like that. So appropriate branch you are going to follow, and then finally you are going to say whether he is going to be tenured or not. Tenured means his position is going to continue or not. Okay. Right. See, the age may be having a number like this, but one of the important things here is that in the decision trees, you have to discretize the values. So here the age is discretized into three values. That because if I am going to test the age, I can't have 100 branches for this one. So that's why age is discretized as less than or equal to 30, 31 to 40, greater than 40. There are three values for the age. This discretization is one of the important problems in the decision tree learning. Right. So once we are having this one, so then we can learn something like this decision tree. And for this one, see, we might be using something like information-based techniques, information gain, Gini index. These are all about entropy kind of thing. These are the information content. It is going to measure the information content. And based on this one, it can create the decision tree, right? And one of the problems is overfitting. We'll see what is this overfitting after some slides, right? So there are some popular techniques like ID3, C4.5, PROT. These techniques are available. You can use this one. Code is available. You can use this one if you are willing to create a decision tree. Okay. Then feature extraction, this one we have seen in the last class also, we have seen, right? This same example may be there here. This same example is there, right? So basis, what is a good basis? This is PCA we have seen. So there is something else apart from PCA for classifier, which is called as Fisher linear discriminant. The important thing is that principal component analysis is a summarization technique. It can be used to generate the data also, whereas this one is a discriminative technique. This cannot be used to generate the data. Discriminative technique. Okay, so PCA we have seen, right? the FLD. So this is called as FLD, Fisher Linear Discriminant, or Fisher Discriminant Analysis. That one, this one we have seen in the last class, right? See, the important thing is that the PCA or SVD is linear in the sense that we used only the linear algebra, right? But non-linear, if you can employ the non-linear projection, you may do much better actually. Instead of doing only the linear transformations, if you can do non-linear transformation, you can do much better. Nowadays, this non-linear transformation based component extraction, this is done by using something called as autoencoder. This is also a neural network kind of thing. It is going to encode and decode. Whatever is going to be the middle layer is going to give is the representation. Okay. Right. So for example, what happens is that in the PCA kind of thing, we assume that the space is Euclidean. Euclidean means, you know, right? The space is like this. We are going to assume like this. But it is not correct actually. The space need not be like that. The space might be actually like this, right? This may be a better space actually to represent. Basis need not be something which is like a Euclidean space basis. Okay. It might be like this, the basis. So these type of things. So now this is the representation actually. This is the encoder. This is the decoder. You can try to encode. You can try to learn this representation. If you want to visualize this one, this is a point actually in this space. In this space is a point. This is a non-linear PCA. One can say that. This is non-linear PCA. Okay. And FLD is going to find the features which are good for doing the discrimination. See, if you employ the PCA, PCA is going to find this one, this direction only. Because for this data, the maximum variance is occurring along that one. So it is going to find that one, right? But this is not good for the classification. So that which is good for the classification is something else actually. If you are going to project onto this line, these feature values are good. They are well separated here. Okay, so FLD is going to find this one. Right. FLD is meant for the classification technique only. Sometimes PCA can do well for classification also, if you are lucky, that's all. Okay. See, the non-linearity is one of the important things nowadays. Non-linearity can be achieved by SVMs. Non-linearity can be achieved by artificial neural networks also. So these are the two important techniques which are prominent in machine learning, SVM and neural networks. Okay. The non-linear feature extraction is what the deep learning is also doing nowadays. So many layers are there, several layers can be there. See, in this case, we are trying to classify the OCR data. OCR data is given like this. And there may be several layers can be there. There is something called as convolution layers and all these things. And finally, what we are going to get here, somewhere here, is the feature vector. This one is the feature vector, somewhere here. This is the feature vector. This, in fact, is nothing but a Fisher non-linear feature vector. They are not linear, Fisher non-linear feature vector, this one is. Once we are having this feature vector here, one can create any linear classifier over this one. It's going to work well. Okay. There is something called as overfitting. Overfitting means the classifier is doing extremely well with the training sets, but is not doing well with the unseen data. That means you created a classifier. Classifier is going to achieve zero error with the training sets, but with the unseen one, there is a lot of error is there. Okay, so that is what is called as overfitting. For example, here, if this is the data is given like this, this is overfitted. That means it is doing extremely well with the training set. That means the complexity of the classifier is too much. Okay. And this classifier, some people will say that this is not at all fitted classifier. And that's why they can say that this is underfitted classifier. This classifier is rightly fitted classifier. Overfitting means the complexity is too much. See, you don't need a 100-layer neural network, but you are having 100-layer neural network. It is going to do extremely well with the training sets, but with the unseen patterns, it will not do well at all. Why? Because it has overfitted itself to the data. Okay. It has overfitted itself to the data. It's almost like remembering the data. Right, see, for example, here, if this is the discriminant we are going to learn, if I am going to give you some pattern, let us say here, some pattern here I am going to give. So obviously it is going to classify that one as what? It is going to classify that one as, if I am going to give this question mark thing here, obviously it is going to classify that one as the red one. Right, but you can see that. It belongs to the black one actually. Okay, so overfitting is one of the important problems, and it can be overcome by something called as generalization ability, or which can be achieved by something called as regularization. Okay, and then the next important thing is that see, some people may believe that ANN is a superior classifier. Okay, you have to use ANN always. Or some people will say that SVM is superior. You have to use SVM. Okay. But actual thing is that this is not known to us actually. Is there one best classifier for us? No, we don't know that one. And this is what is called as a free lunch theorem. It's called as no free lunch theorem. Even the rote learning may be a competing classifier. You can't say that this is good classifier, right? See, Occam's razor says that it is good to choose the simplest classifier. The simplest classifier is going to avoid overfitting. This is what Occam's razor has said. Okay. How to avoid overfitting is that this, if you are having many possible answers, choose that answer which is simpler. Right. So instead of trying to minimize only the training error, minimize this one. That is, minimize the complexity of the classifier also. Right, so this can be achieved by regularization, and we are having something called as L1 regularization, L2 regularization, all these things are there. And nowadays in the deep learning, there are some techniques like dropout is there, all these things are there. Okay, right. This is the no free lunch theorem. No classifier is inherently better than any other. Okay. See, every classifier has its own data over which it is going to win. That's why there are so many classifiers are there. Right? And how much time is there for us? 11:15. The unsupervised is when the labels are not given to us. When the labels are not given, we first have to give the labels. Right. How to give the labels for the data is called as clustering. The clustering techniques, there are several techniques are there. This is labeling the data, that's all. Okay. So K-means is there. K-means can label the data. Right. Similarly, there are many other techniques are there. Hierarchical clustering techniques like single link techniques are there. Or something like DB scan is there. Okay. Nowadays, in the deep learning community, we are having something called as a Siamese neural network. That means it's like two neural networks. Okay. Instead of having one neural network, you can have two neural networks. And by using that one also, you can find a good representation. And over that representation, if you are going to employ something like K-means, it is going to do extremely well. Okay. This is nowadays it is being done like this, and there is something called as semi-supervised learning also. Semi-supervised learning is in between supervised and unsupervised learning. Okay. So with this, I'm going to stop this presentation. If you're having any questions, you can ask me. It's 11:15 now. If you're having any questions, you can ask me.
Participants, any queries? Sir, there's a question in the chat box, sir.
Oh. Okay. Yeah, you can ask me also. I am trying to see the chat box. So, Q learning. What is semi-supervised learning on reinforcement learning? I think I explained about reinforcement learning. Semi-supervised means we are having data. We are having data where for some data labels are there, for some data labels are not there. If the data is like that, then how is that we are going to use this data? Labeled data as well as unlabeled data. Both are given. Then how is that we are going to learn the classifier, or how is that we are going to label the unlabeled data? That is what is called as semi-supervised learning. Okay, reinforcement learning, I told that, right? It is more or less a trial and error, but it is based on the reward and punishment strategy. We are going to learn the strategy there. Which strategy is suitable for that given problem? At a given environment, what is the correct step to take? Okay. These are all some comments as we went on. Any other question? Q learning. Prakash Meena is asking, what is Q learning? I don't know what is Q learning. What is Q learning? Does anybody know that? Are there any other questions which I can answer? I'm willing to answer. I don't know what is this Q learning.
So it's a reinforcement learning algorithm, it seems.
Okay, okay. It is a specific reinforcement learning algorithm. Okay.
Where can we apply them?
See, reinforcement learning is applicable in places where it's like robot navigation or autonomous car driving vehicle, where based on the environment, the next step has to be taken. It's not single step or single label actually. There are several actions are possible. What is the optimal action at that stage? Okay. And mostly that is done by the Markov decision process or something like that. It is not supervised learning actually. It is not unsupervised learning also. It is different from all these things.
Okay. Participants, if you have any other queries.
Sir, related to multi-class labels, how to calculate the accuracy, precision, those values, sir?
Even if multi-class problem is there, classification accuracy or classification error can be found. For machine learning, normally we say classification accuracy or classification error, that's all. If it is a retrieval problem, then precision recall will come into picture. That is also a measure, how much precise you are able to retrieve from the given database based on the query you want to retrieve something. If that is the problem, then precision and the recall may be the measures. If it is a supervised problem, that means you are trying to classify something, then classification accuracy or classification error are good enough actually.
Okay, sir.
See, one important thing is that the SVM looks like a binary classifier. If you want to extend SVM to multi-class classifier, it is not so simple actually. Whereas artificial neural network, by definition, is a multi-class classifier. So artificial neural network employing it to multi-class classification is straightforward. But SVM employing it to multi-class classification is not straightforward. You have to do something in between. Okay. SVM basically is a binary classifier. That means only two class classification problem it can handle. Okay.
Any other? So if no queries are there, I'd like to thank Vishwanath sir for sparing his valuable time with us and enlightening us with machine learning techniques. It's really a wonderful session, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Okay. Thank you. So thank you all for giving me this opportunity. Especially thank you to Professor Prabhavindu for this opportunity. Thank you.
It's our pleasure, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Right. So I can share the slides. I will send the slides through email to you.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay.
Yes, sir. We'll share it to all the participants. So.
Right, right.
Thank you,
okay,
sir.
Okay, then.
Thank you very much. Participants, we'll have a break and we'll rejoin at 11:30.